The Arctic conjures up images of remote tundra and sub-zero temperatures. It appears an inhospitable place that is as inaccessible to all but the hardiest of adventurers. However, such is the popularity of its signature species, the polar bear, that even tourists are drawn to this area. Now tourists from all over the world come to the Arctic in the hope of witnessing this magnificent creature. Getting to see a polar bear in the wild can be very difficult in much of the Arctic, which is as inaccessible as it seems. However, Churchill in Canada is an exception. Not only can it be reached by a 2.5-hour flight from Winnipeg, but also between October and December, the chance of seeing a polar bear there is very good indeed. Well, this is the Churchill River, and this is what it's all about. Behind me, you can see the sea ice beginning to form, and it is this that draws the polar bears to Churchill. This is what makes Churchill the self-proclaimed polar bear capital of the world. They come here in October and they're waiting simply for this ice to freeze over. Once it's frozen over, then they're off into the Hudson Bay. The role of the Churchill River in the formation of the sea ice is crucial because fresh water freezes quicker than salt water. As the freezing ice pours from the river to the Hudson Bay, the latter in turn begins to freeze over. Although the Hudson Bay is relatively shallow, it takes some time before it is sufficiently solid to bear the weight of a polar bear. Accordingly, bears will test the solidity of the ice. Here, it seems solid enough, but despite careful testing, the initial promise was not fulfilled. The sea ice is important to the polar bears because of the way it hunts its preferred prey, the ring seal. Using its keen sense of smell, it locates the seal's den and then will punch right through the ice to catch its prey. Here we see the bear testing the ice but without making a breakthrough. Bears can of course swim, but their chances of catching a seal while hunting in the water are significantly less good. As this grain elevator illustrates, Churchill is a base for the shipment of grain, principally to Europe. In fact, Churchill is Canada's principal seaport in the Arctic, although it only acquired this status in the 20th century. There are, however, no road links between Churchill and the rest of Canada. The grain reaches the town by train. That, though, is a three-day journey, because the permafrost buckles the rails. Accordingly, the train cannot travel very fast. Indeed, the service is so unreliable that, although it is scheduled at twice a week, an arrival of a train in Churchill is a big media event. The town has less than 2,000 inhabitants, more than 50% of whom make their living from tourism. It has a long history, although this is not revealed in its architecture. The earliest inhabitants of the area were the Dorset and pre-Dorset people, who were nomads living off the ring seals and the caribou. They built underground pit houses which formed their residence in the winter. During the summer, they lived in tents. They arrived in about 1700 BC. They were in turn replaced by the Thule, who arrived in about 1000 AD. They were the ancestors of the Inuit and were also hunters. Europeans arrived in the 17th century in search first of the Northwest Passage and then furs. They had more luck with the latter than the former. Both the Dane, Jens Munk, and much later the Englishman, James Franklin, made ill-fated expeditions to the area in search of the Northwest Passage. As for the fur trade, the English and the French battled over this for centuries. The Hudson Bay Company was formed in 1670 with a monopoly of trade in furs in the area. The town was the site of the first astronomical observations in Canada in 1769. In 1783, work was commenced on Fort Churchill. It remained in continuous occupation until 1933. In more recent times, the town has been relocated to the other side of the river. Although bears remain the principal tourist attraction, it is also known for its beluga whales and the aurora borealis. The belugas can be seen from mid-July to mid-August. Although there were contradictory predictions as to whether the aurora could be seen in mid-November, I had high hopes of witnessing a display of this amazing spectacle. Unfortunately, the aurora was not visible during my stay, and I could only ponder with the magic of Photoshop on the sight I could have seen. As for the bears, Churchill had no shortage of those. Indeed, I was frequently to hear in the night warning shots designed to scare the bears away from the town. There were constant patrols by the bear rescue teams trapping and removing bears. Those who are persistent offenders are put into polar bear jail. The experience is not designed to make them eager to return. After a brief stay, they are tranquilized and then airlifted out by helicopter to a remote region of the tundra. I was to witness this on the day of my arrival in Churchill. Were not the only wildlife I was to see in the vicinity of the town. The highlight, after a week's abortive attempts, was seeing this Arctic hare. Here it has adopted its winter coat and blends in perfectly with the snow, save for the black tips on the ears. These resemble eyes to its aerial predators, and accordingly are an important defence mechanism. The best wildlife viewing in the area is, of course, on the tundra itself and in the specially adapted polar rovers. In the interests of conservation, a limited number of permits are granted each day to explore the tundra in these vehicles, and the drivers are not permitted to stray from the tracks. Some specially adapted vehicles are parked in the tundra for use as a hotel, and it was towards these we headed. Not surprisingly, the bears were attracted to this area by the rich cocktail of smells they produced. However, their pleas for food went in vain. There is a strict rule against feeding the bears for understandable reasons. We were to see many times bears engaged in play fighting. At this stage, the bears are not trying to hurt each other. It appears, by contrast, that they are seeking to establish which of them will have dominance in the event of a real conflict. Older bears fight bloody battles to win the right to mate with an available female, and if a bear knows where it is in the pecking order, it can avoid a potentially fatal encounter with a rival. The bouts usually last for 15 minutes, but this bear continued at it for well over an hour, with short breaks between each encounter. has been suggested that polar bears, especially young males, form friendships which can last for weeks or even years. That runs counter to their image as solitary predators out on the sea ice. However, viewing these bears together, it was not difficult to believe that they were indeed on very friendly terms. It has also been suggested that only well-fed bears engage in play fighting. That is perhaps open to doubt. Play fighting is common while the bears are waiting for the sea ice to form. During that period, there is not much food for them to eat, and they survive on their fat reserves. By the time the sea ice forms, the bears are actively hunting the ringed seals and replenishing their fat reserves. Play fighting at that time would seem, therefore, to have a very low priority. In fact, when the ringed seals are available, the bear must manage a kill every 5 or 6 days if it is to maintain its body weight. In the absence of its preferred diet, it is forced to scavenge. Prior to the sea ice forming, it will eat anything from carrion to plants. Here, I was to see them eating seaweed, not the most enticing of meals, but better than nothing. This bear appeared to be sniffing out a meal, but without success. Not surprisingly, the bears cannot wait for the sea ice to form. One could be forgiven for thinking that this bear was trying out the ice, hoping that it would be possible for him to resume hunting his preferred prey. When it proved that this was not the case, the disappointment of the bears was palpable. Where, as here, the ice is not sufficiently solid for the bears to walk on easily, they try to spread out their weight to avoid breaking through it. This is not always effective. Here, the water was not deep, and quite why the bears repeatedly tested the thickness of the ice after breaking through it was something of a mystery. Perhaps they were hoping some of it was sufficiently solid to walk on. However, in the absence of a stable platform to hunt from, there was not much else for them to do, and so they resumed play fighting. We eventually left the polar bears free to spar in peace and headed out to explore more of the tundra. I was very excited when our guide Mike spotted a snowy owl a although it was quite distant. These are the largest birds in the area, with an average wingspan of 5.5 feet. It is a master of camouflage and can swivel its head 270 degrees. Its main prey are lemmings and mice. By the time we saw this polar bear, the weather was bleak and the light was fading fast. We left the tundra at 4 and returned to Churchill. The following morning was no less desolate than the night before. Astonishingly, I had seen people walking the streets in the early hours, despite the ever-present bears. This was not a course I decided to adopt, and these shots were taken within 5 meters of my lodge. Churchill is situated at the juncture of 3 ecoregions: the boreal forest to the south, the Arctic tundra to the northwest, and the Hudson Bay to the north. These varied habitats support a range of wildlife. Both squirrel and red fox are to be seen here, the latter frequently. As for the bird life, we were to see chickadee and grey jays. Pine grosbeaks, which are present in this area, we did not see. Interesting as it undoubtedly was exploring these other habitats, we were anxious to get back to the tundra and to see more bears. That we were to do in the evening after the sun had gone down. We had been primed that our visit at that time would not necessarily be a great wildlife viewing event, a prediction that proved to be accurate. We were to see a couple of polar bears sleeping, but not much else. We returned to the tundra the following morning at dawn. Almost immediately, we were to see 2 polar bears bathed in the morning light. They were initially some distance away. The first headed in our general direction, but in the end passed in front of the vehicles and over to the other side of the tundra. The second, by contrast, headed right up to the vehicles, in the vain hope of finding something to eat. Most of the tundra is pretty flat. However, there are a few elevated sections, and this is where a sow and her 2 cubs chose to rest. They would periodically raise their heads in order to check the danger, then resume sleeping. The importance of the sow and cubs sleeping on an elevated section of the tundra and maintaining a watch quickly became apparent. A big male appeared on the horizon and started to walk towards them. Male polar bears will eat cubs. Therefore, his presence presented a very real threat to the family. The danger was not spotted until right at the last minute, and then the sow and cubs showed a real turn of speed in making their escape. As for the male, he continued to lumber after them at his usual leisurely pace for some time before he gave up the pursuit. A female with cubs represents more to a male than a feeding opportunity. Once he smells the female, he rolls in the snow in joyful anticipation of some collateral benefits. On this occasion, the male got neither a meal nor any other benefit, and so there was nothing better to do than to have a rest. In a different part of the tundra, we were to see again a female with 2 cubs. On this occasion, they were eating kelp. Polar bears are, of course, primarily carnivorous and only look beyond their preferred food of ring seals when that is unavailable. Then they will eat almost anything they can find, regardless of its nutritional value. Because kelp has almost no nutritional value, scientists have pondered why the bears bother to eat it at all. It has been concluded that they do this to fill in the time. Whether or not that is true, we were to see these bears eating kelp for a prolonged period before the sow decided it was time for them to move off. It was some time before we saw them again. By this time, the weather had turned the worst, and the sow was leading her cubs across the tundra in the driving snow. One cub decided to go it alone. The other followed her as she searched for a place where she could find some shelter from the blizzard. Her first choice proved unsuitable, but it didn't take her long to find another place where she could dig a pit and then settle herself down to suckle the cub. In due course, the other cub was to rejoin them, and then both cubs made up for the lack of sustenance they had received from the kelp. The sow, however, simply went hungry. This tender moment contrasted vividly with the activity of two males a short time later. At first, nothing amiss appeared to be the case. One passed the other on the tundra without either of them paying any attention to the event. A short while later, the other followed, but again nothing untoward happened. There was subsequently an apparent invitation to a mock bout. However, when sparring did commence, it was anything but playful. Both bears seemed to be much more serious than the ones we had seen earlier, and the bout lasted considerably longer than the mock sparring we had seen then. Indeed, it had not concluded before we had to leave. It left us with a vivid memory of just how brutal the Arctic can be. Polar bears may look to our eyes like oversized teddy bears, but their savagery could not have been more amply demonstrated. As we left the sparring polar bears, we returned to the settlement of Churchill. We had a further night there before flying to Winnipeg and our onward destinations.